Yeah, my name's Roy Miller. I'm a mostly retired family doc in Somerville, Maine. And my son, Brian, was always interested in our heritage. We thought it was Russian, but probably it turned out my grandpa probably came over from Poland. And then now it's Belarus, where we're from. And so Brian, when he got out of high school, changed his name back to the Milakovsky, the family name, and took Russian and went to Russia and Ukraine a couple of times, and then ended up after grad school at Yale in forestry, and ended up in Vladivostok, Russia for 5 years, which is the Far East. That's the main of Russia. And spent 5 years there working with WWF, trying to preserve forests for the leopards and tigers, the emerald tigers and leopards. And went back to Ukraine after the first war because he wanted to see what had happened. He was so disappointed. And when he returned to Russia, basically got harassed out. They assumed he was a spy and basically chased him out of Russia. So he went back to Ukraine. He's been there since 2015 and went to Far Eastern Ukraine near the border with the occupied territory. And initially he was working with Mercy Corps, and they were giving out these little mini grants, $500 kind of grants that would allow a farmer to put up a new greenhouse. Things are so inexpensive there, or some other way to start a small business back up, because they'd all lost their market, which was Donetsk, the city of 500,000 people that was now on the Russian side of the occupied territory. Then he switched. When that ended, he worked with writing some grants for a couple of organizations that were trying to get USAID money, and went to work for one of them, doing a little more advanced work of the same idea. Organized a group of apple growers into a co-op and got them to market and be able to sell again, and putting together other kinds of businesses, most of which is agricultural there. And then kept running into the bureaucracy with USAID. So in the end, our family ended up doing some things. We put a roof on a children's center that USAID didn't want to fund, and a mining school college, which had moved out of the occupied territory, came to their area, and we rehabbed a couple floors of a dormitory for them. And ironically, they just evacuated again from Severodonetsk to farther west. And also a counseling center for some psychologists who were working with kids who had been traumatized by being displaced out of their homes. And, you know, the numbers were much smaller in the first war. This time it's going to be huger. That's probably not the best sentence. But anyway, it's going to be, you know, a lot more traumatized kids. He got married. We actually went over for the ceremony last year. And they have a child, 3-month-old, and Brian and Anna had spent 6 months remodeling an apartment there to move into. And we're in it for about 3 months before this all started. And they originally moved to Kyiv, figuring that would be safer, about 3 weeks ago, and then realized that wasn't safe and headed to Lviv, which is right on the Polish border. And the day the war broke out, they spent a couple hours getting their dog into a kennel and headed to the border, and found about a 1 mile backup line, which would have been 24 hours. And they weren't sure how to handle that with the baby. Thought about going back to Lviv, but they were playing with her outside of the car, and a car going the other way stopped, and a priest jumped out and said, "You need to move to the front of the line. You've got an infant." And they went up there and the border guard agreed, and there were more like 10 cars from the front, and they got into Poland. And then they have slowly moved further along to safe places. So they're very safe at the moment, but pretty traumatized. Anna's parents were still back in Severodonetsk. And between all of them, there were 3 apartments, and 2 have had their windows blown out. We really don't know what's happened to Brian and Anna's new apartment, but they know from pictures that the grocery store nearby and the school nearby have been destroyed. And so Brian, over the years, had made a lot of contacts there. And one thing he was really impressed by was that the evangelical groups and the fundamentalist Baptist groups really did stuff on the ground in the first war. They were the ones who would go into the danger zones and pick people up and help them and bring in food. And so, and he's seen that continue over the years. So he's been funneling money mostly to these groups who are using it to buy diesel fuel for their buses and vans and to buy food, and sending Brian these pictures of hundreds of receipts so we know it's all being spent. And they, you know, yesterday they went into Severodonetsk and evacuated, I don't know, 186 people or something. One of the groups they evacuated was this mining college again, the same one that had already evacuated once. And they bring in, when they go in with the buses, they bring food. So the money's being used very directly and right where it can actually do the most good. You know, all the international organizations are pretty much spending their money at the borders for people who have gotten out, which is great. But Brian said to me the other day, this every dollar we can get it there now is probably worth $40 in a month to save lives. And again, we get this, these large groups of volunteers who are willing to drive back into the danger areas. Originally, they were trying to bring people out to a train station, but they realized it was just hopeless to get people on the trains. And now they pick them up and then drive the bus as far as they got to go to get to a border. So they may be on the buses 12 hours with the women and children. And on his wife's parents and grandfather were stubborn about leaving Severodonetsk. And Brian finally convinced them to try to go, and they got a ride to the train station, couldn't get on the train, went back. And then luckily her father's boss had two cars, and they all, and Brian called the boss and absolutely convinced them they had to get out of there. And they headed west in the two cars and caught in huge traffic jams. Took them about 2 days and they got to the border and they got out. So that was a huge relief to Brian and of course to his wife. And they're heading to Latvia, where they've been promised employment and a place to live, all of which has been, you know, pretty much of a total shock. And unfortunately, their town of Severodonetsk, which is, you know, as I say, quite close to the eastern border, has been very heavily bombed. Brian's sense is that if the Russians do take it over, it'll be a ghost town by then, because there wouldn't be any reason for anybody to stay. And there's very few people there who wanted the Russians, and the ones who were became alienated by the war. So that's how we've gotten to where we are now. Yeah, there's Severodonetsk and the Russian, let me see. You know, the Russians had occupied all this area back in 2014. So Severodonetsk was about 20 miles from the line. And these two provinces, Luhansk and oblasts they're called, but Luhansk and Donetsk are the two that at the beginning of the war, Russia said they just wanted to take those whole provinces, their whole oblasts. But obviously that's not what they really wanted. So then they went to Kyiv, you know, which...
It's right there.
Right, you would, you know, like say, thinking that was safe. And then to Lviv.
Which is over here.
Right, and then into Poland. Brian was really impressed how wonderful the Poles have been. They were extremely accommodating and helpful. And part of the reason they moved on is they felt like they need to make room for other people coming in who, you know, Brian and Anna got to leave with a car full of stuff. They were much better off than a lot of people.
Yeah. Can you explain what the family is doing?
They are hunkering down for a while. His wife, you know, this is Europe, so his wife's on a year's maternity leave because they, you know, treat mothers well there. And Brian's work has mostly now been trying to see if he can get his fellow employees out. USAID was very stubborn about it, not wanting to help people leave because for fear if the bus they were on got damaged that they would get blamed. And so their response to that is to do nothing. So Brian's been working a lot, trying to make sure his employees are okay and fellow employees. And then a huge amount of this time working with the people he knows. And so each day he's been publishing Facebook posts showing what they're doing with the money and what they're doing with people. It's been very helpful for them because buying diesel, they can't run their buses and vans if they don't have diesel. Yeah, I'm at the supermarket. We'll call.
It means a lot to be able to support evacuation of our neighbors. The city where Anna is from, and I have lived since 2015. And since 2014, it's been the temporary capital of the Luhansk region, while the city of Luhansk is under separatist Russian control. When Russia began its murderous new war on February 24th, it made this city one of its targets and has been pounding the city with artillery and grad rockets. I don't know what that is. Few of the places you know in the city have been left unscarred and dozens of people killed. Funds went towards two different evacuation convoys, first by a group called DEMA and the folks at somebody called Cynical Chaplain. Together, they've evacuated 266 people from various bomb shelters and dormitories where they're taking refuge. The core groups were students and staff who fled. And then we have also shared funds with the university vice rector, a Russian name, to continue evacuation of these students. Besides evacuation, these volunteers, heroes, distributed hundreds of loaves of bread, groceries for displaced persons, and refreshing the fuel supplies for more evacuation runs today and tomorrow. There should be a humanitarian corridor out of Severodonetsk, but the shelling hasn't let up yet.
I'll put up the links if people do want to donate. I'm leaving Saturday, so checks are hard to get to me in time. But people could. Probably if they got mailed Monday, would get to me. But otherwise, I'll put up the PayPal and the Venmo links. Yeah, what we actually do is I move it into Brian's checking account here in Maine. And then we do a wire transfer to his Ukrainian checking account because he has to get it to Ukraine to be useful. And so I go to the bank every couple of days and make a wire transfer.
Can we?
Okay, I think it worked this time.
Fantastic.
Can you hear me now?
We can.
Great. I'm so sorry. Technical difficulties and a little mix up, but great. I don't know how much Dad was able to cover.
Well, we got a welcome and we got the links to where we can donate to give money directly. Okay. And if you want to give us like a live report from where you're at and what's happening today over there.
Okay, fantastic. So yes, I'm not in Ukraine anymore. I'm with my wife and baby, and now my mother arrived today, which is great to help us. We're in Croatia. We were ahead of the wave always by several days. We kept moving west as the sort of war clouds gathered, because this was a very telegraphed disaster. We saw it coming in slow motion, which is really awful. And everyone kept thinking, they can't go this far. They can't possibly be so irrational as to launch a full war on Ukraine. And that's what's so mind-boggling in the situation is how deeply irrational this war is. It's becoming already a disaster for Russia. And yet they just keep pressing forward, and their only solution seems to be more violence. That is all that they appear to know how to do in this situation is add more violence when things don't go their way. So where we are right now is that they truly have brought the war to the entirety of Ukraine. Strangely, the western part of the country where anti-Russian feeling is the strongest and where Russians often have the most answering hostility has suffered the least. And Russia is instead absolutely pounding those parts of the country it incorrectly believes are quietly, secretly yearning to become a part of Russia. And so it's all the more impossible to understand because Russia and its leader, Vladimir Putin, seem to be concentrating misery and destruction in those parts of Ukraine they believed would greet them as liberators. They were so wrong. I don't think maybe since the Iraq War, we've seen such a incredible misunderstanding and miscalculation about another culture before an invasion. And it's especially mind-boggling because Russians believe, many Russians, it's truly not the president. I lived in Russia for a long time. Unfortunately, it's a widespread belief there that we are one country. Those Ukrainians are deceived by the West and by demagogues into believing that they're a different country. And so Russians believe that they intrinsically understand Ukrainians. And that mistake is at the root of this stupid, vicious war, which they, in one way or another, will lose, Russia. But they are first in just rolling out massive violence. So they're concentrating it, as I said, in the parts of the country east, around Kyiv and east of the Dnipro River that sort of divides the country in two. And some of the worst damage is in the Donbas region, which is where there's been a low-level war since 2014. And I've been working for USAID and before that other humanitarian donors to respond to that smaller war, which was a precursor to this one. And so there was tons of military infrastructure in the region already for lots of violence when this war began in the east. And that's what we're seeing. At present, Russia is simply bombarding into ruins the largest government-controlled city in the east, Mariupol, which is a beautiful, it was really a city on the up and up. It's a steel mining, it's a steel making town on the Azov Sea coast. Tons of history, multi-ethnic, Ukrainians, Russians, Greeks, Armenians. Beautiful city, so much character. I love Mariupol, and they are destroying it. It will be like Aleppo when they're done. The Russians have truly chosen the same model of warfare they used in Syria against Ukraine, against cities where they thought they would be welcomed as liberators. Again, I can't stress how bizarre this war is. And they're also using intense violence against smaller cities. Unfortunately, it's impossible for us to help Mariupol right now. It is surrounded and under aerial and artillery bombardment. But we can help smaller cities in the east that have a humanitarian channel to the rest of the country. And I'm really focused on the communities where I lived and worked until January. Mostly we've been organizing, not organizing actually, it's important to note, volunteers are organizing, we are helping with money. We are simply pumping more money into a grassroots Ukrainian volunteer effort. That's very important. Definitely no Western saviors here. The huge Western international aid community is hunkered down, not moving until things calm down. And it's crazy brave Ukrainian volunteers making this all work. And we are just putting money in their accounts so they can keep going. So we are mostly buying diesel money and money to buy groceries for volunteer efforts to evacuate people from the small cities where I worked and was living. Places like Severodonetsk, Lysychansk, Popasna, Volnovakha. These are just little industrial and mining towns that are unfortunate to be in an arc of territory the Russians want to get control of, probably to drive a harder bargain with Ukraine when they finally come to a peace agreement. And possibly they want to take this territory and make it part of their puppet separatist state, the People's Republics of Luhansk and Donetsk, which is completely a dependent Russian puppet, where people have been tragically suffering the last 8 years because of the war. now Russia would like to extend that territory to the cities I was talking about, and so is wrecking them in order to drive Ukrainian army out of those cities and be able to symbolically expand its so-called People's Republic. Ukrainian army, and I would say with a quite strong basis of public support, is not abandoning these cities, but it means they're being pounded into rubble. So I think a big moral question, would it be better to give them up? I think many, many residents now are so angry at Russia that they don't want to be taken over by whoever would treat their city and them in this way. But the price will be extremely high. So we're evacuating people. Volunteers, many of whom are from Baptist and evangelical churches. It's important to note they have an intense service-oriented faith and have been heroic volunteers since 2014, going into some of the hottest spots. So some of the volunteers we're supporting are from those churches. Some are local administrators. Some are local NGOs. They're packing people into vans and driving them to safer towns where there are displaced person welcome centers. They're fed, and then as much as possible, they're put on trains. It's quieter. It's still the less bombarded part of the country. That's really the focus right now, because every dollar spent on evacuation now is, of course, you know, will be $100, $200 in a couple of months or in a year when it'll be recovery time. Although eventually with the money we're raising, I do hope we can address some longer term things like food security. A lot of elderly people in the region feed themselves from little dacha plots that they have had all their lives outside the city that they were given in Soviet times. It's extremely important that they be able to get out there and plant food for themselves and for their neighbors and relatives. Without public transport, they can't get there. So we're thinking when the bombing becomes less intense, if it will be possible or stops entirely, to organize buses out to the dacha districts so that people can get themselves, can start planting their gardens. They usually have something like a third of an acre. So, you know, for a family, that's a pretty good plot. We'll be looking at all kinds of things, but right now we're definitely focused on evacuation. Today, those volunteers evacuated. Yesterday, they evacuated 266 people in vehicles we helped fuel up. Today, I think 80 plus on, about close to 300. It's an effort in motion. We're trying to get buses deeper into the more bombed communities, closer to the front line. There's real risk for the people behind the wheel. No one's forcing them. So it's a, you know, there's some, we are trying to balance common sense with the need to get people out of these communities and somewhere safer. So that's it in a nutshell.
Thank you, Brian. Two things. I wonder if you have time for just a couple of questions. One is if your baby's around, if we could see the picture of a baby.
she's breastfeeding. Let me throw one in the chat. Yeah. Let me tell you what is happening is that actually massive amounts of humanitarian aid are getting stuck in Western Ukraine. There's a big effort, including by the Ukrainian diaspora in the United States. Poland is really, really being an incredibly good neighbor to Ukraine right now. But logistics do not allow a lot of this stuff to get across the country. And so some of the worst hit communities in the East are really not getting enough assistance, not because they're being ignored, but because we can't figure out the logistics yet. Yeah. So that's what I'm really focused on. Finding the volunteers who have a working system. They know where to buy some food. They know where to get diesel. And we are just putting oil in the tank. You know, we're putting diesel in the tank. That's our job.
This war is by Russia to denazify Ukraine. Can you respond to that?
That's a really important question. I'm Jewish. I take the threat of the far right in Ukraine very seriously. Ukraine has a serious problem with the far right. Ukraine has a troubled history with anti-Semitism, with ethnic cleansing in earlier generations of Poles. But that it is not a country controlled by Nazis. That is a Russian fantasy that they use to justify their own imperial policies. Russia does not acknowledge that Ukraine is a different culture, not one that's alien to them. They're close, they are relatives, but it will not acknowledge that they have agency and that they have sovereignty. And in it can't say that openly. It can't just say, we refuse to let this little country exist. It's not a little country, actually. It's an enormous country, but compared to Russia, it's little. And so the Nazi element is their emotional manipulation of a real problem that's this big. And I'm not saying it's a small one. It threatens Ukraine's future. Ukraine needs to confront its far right. It needs to work on the same way we do in the United States. I mean, look, see how the alt-right came out of the woodwork. You know, we didn't realize it was such a problem. It's a serious problem in Ukraine, but it is absolutely not the case that the country's government is controlled by Nazis. I participate in our local Jewish community in the city where we escaped from, and at a national level in some Jewish organizations. Jewish communities do not feel threatened by their neighbors or by the Ukrainian state. And most of them have spoken up to say, this war is fascist. So thank you for bringing that up. We need to be vigilant about the problem of the far right in Ukraine, but there is no justification for a war by Russia to remove some fictional fascist government in Ukraine.
On that lovely note, we'll let you go, and thank you so much for being with us. Bye, Brian.
Thank you.
Bye, all.